So, the purpose of this session is to give you a chance to think about what your principles of assessment are. So, it links to what David was talking about in the keynote, about we can present the framework, but it's about local implementation. So I want you to think about your situation, your context, and your discipline. So I have done this with much larger groups before, so we'll have to kind of see how this goes. It might take a little bit less time than the full allotted time. We'll see how our conversations go, plenty of time for the discussion. What I'd like you to do is have a look at the pictures on this table and choose three pictures that represent to you something about good assessment. Okay? So I'll leave it as flexible as that. Now, some people find it a bit of a struggle to work visually. So I've also got some blank pieces of card if you want to use a word to describe what good assessment means to you. But give yourself a bit of time, there's no rush, and choose three pictures, like I said, that represent something about good assessment or what good assessment means. Get up.
Well, I'm sad. You don't do
come on,
often.
Come on, Karen.
Don't get a wheelie chair.
So there are some duplicates in there.
How many are you supposed to have?
Three.
Oh.
How many have you got?
Carolyn's got six. No, more than that.
Oh my goodness.
Let's have got 13.
13?
Yeah. Oh, blimey.
You might want to...
Someone same thing, actually.
I'll let you have four.
There's something that I've got three.
That's as far as your pets go.
Well, we've got a lot of time anyway. So.
Okay. Well, what I normally do, the next
apologize.
Bit, is that I pair people up and then pairs speak to other pairs. So we're going to have to skip that and just go with a trio. So if we start with you, Karen, and if you can describe to the other two as to what you've chosen and why you've chosen it, and then we'll do that in turn.
So both of those are about direction. Sign pointing. They're conflicting actually. One is about clear sign pointing and one is about allowing a bit of choice there also, being very clear. This one is about being about science, biological sciences, about that being very clear, linking assessment to what we're trying to teach overall, and charming and kind of clear how it fits into the curriculum. This one's about enjoying it. These two about being creative and kind of creativity. This one is about skills, like treating information and skills. This one is about, actually it's a bit of contractual, so like I do stuff and you do stuff. So I do things.
Okay, that was rapid.
Is that right?
Yeah, very rapid. Okay, so talk about yours and maybe elaborate a little bit further.
Oh, right, sorry, so we can come back.
That's all right,
we'll. Okay. So very similar, one of the first picture I've got is Gabe with Path. So he's being really clear to the students is really important and getting an understanding. So to me that represents ensuring that the students are well informed at the start of the module, so they can tailor their learning specifically to the learning outcomes and they can see the relevance of practice, especially with our course being allied health, a very profession-orientated key set skills, that they can relate that into what does that mean for me as the professional, and move forward and have their own guide of knowledge as to how they're going to pass the knowledge of module, but also how that informs practice. And then I picked a very similar card to yourself, and I picked the book with the glasses and the highlighters. And I think this, to me, represents that there's obviously, as higher educational lecturers, these are important for us to ensure that our students know what they're doing, why they're doing it, and guide them through the process of learning. But also that there's a contractual, like you see, you've got a contract. There's a contractual responsibility that the student has to take onus on their learning, and that all assessment tasks, no matter how much weighting they're all hard in their own way, and that depends on the student's interpretation of that module and how they go about learning that module, and they have to accept that responsibility. So it's supposed to be looking at the student charter, isn't it, and that they've got a responsibility to themselves to develop their own learning and understanding and learn so far that I can facilitate them through that process. There's always been a bit of a slight tear with everything you know, you've seen, so you've got to work for it. Not that I want to cause pain to my students, but I can't just hand out really credits. And then at the end of the journey, I picked, this is the only card that I could really see that I thought fitted and represented what ideally the outcome would be, and that is like I suppose this, you've got a multitude of different professions here, you've got a multitude of different sciences, so that holistic approach, that lateral thinker, that critical thinker, that person that develops not interpersonally but also looks at their community and social and cultural responsibility as a professional when they come to develop.
How does that fit then with assessment? Because what you've talked about sounds broader than just assessment. So if you, what you just said about holistic approach, how does that fit into what makes assessment good? I think you're right, but what
so I've gathered the consensus of the overall, once the students pass, what I expect the student to start to gain as they graduate from university. So if I was going to do that as a specific assessment, then that would be ensuring timely, obviously depending on where the assessment is in their level of study, ensuring that the student has that clarity in their development academically, so they can see that they're improving their critical skills, that their social skills, their interpersonal skills, they have got transferable skills and can work more collaboratively. But obviously that has to be tailored at the level. So I think I'm just broadly going course-wise rather than module-specific. If I was looking at module-specific, a module that I'm working on, if we look at patient-centred care, we look at the holistic values of patient-centred care. So at the end of that module, I expect that student to have deepened their reflective skills and their interpersonal skills and being able to have more empathy, what we call soft skills, and look at the how socially people develop certain behaviours, health behaviours, and have a better, empathetic understanding of how a patient might, you know, present to us and how we could potentially holistically manage that patient rather than stereotypical, this patient's got this, put you in that box, but actually take them out of the box, spread the problems out. It makes sense without being specifically.
And then it's some of the program level outcomes.
The overall course.
Because you've got program level,
and then
you've got program level at each level, haven't you? So what you're talking about is some of the things that you're the program is anticipating that they will grow, if you like, through. But they're not module specific, much more progress, it's more of a, do they call it program centred approach?
Yeah, so it's having that kind of, so obviously I've got my module, I've got my key learning objectives that I've made clear to my students and the study to. But ideally, at the end of it, I want them to gain some extra insight that wasn't on the marking criteria, some further development, not only interpersonally, but also looking at their social wider context of how they interact in the community.
So what you're saying about holistic approach is the whole thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's what you expect as your course within your module. You expect when they leave as professionals to have that almost like an ethos, isn't it? So then naturally the assessment in the course, in the module, fits within that holistic approach. But so for you, it is everything, isn't it?
Yeah.
That approach is important to every aspect.
That creates intervention rather than measuring within the module whether or not the students reach those outcomes within the module. It's a much broader look.
Yeah.
What you're producing, what you as a teacher are helping to develop within the.
Well, I suppose we do that throughout the course though. If I just look back at our course, we have very specific module outcomes that are very measurable, but we also have an element of therapeutic care written in every single assignment or assessment, and we always talk to them about that, even if it's a practical exam, we talk to them about, you know, role play, and imagine you're in a clinic for the first time, this is your patient, how you've been taught it, how you've managed it, and we'll reflect on that and give them feedback about their, you know, their soft skills, their approachability, their communication skills, because they're key to them being a good health professional at the end of it. I mean, you can have all this great theoretical knowledge and ability to do handling skills, but if you can't talk and communicate to your patient, you might as well forget it, because you're not going to extract the information that you need. So they're kind of embedded throughout the whole course. Obviously, at a teacher level, so obviously at first years, you know, we give them a little bit of immunity, a lot of nerves. But when they get to level six, we expect them to be, you know, very proactive in the way that they interact in the exam.
Can I ask a question? I mean, if you're actually, when you've gone in to teach this particular module, you've got the sort of the module level criteria. How have you engaged with the fact that there are these broader attributes, if you like, that you want to develop as a team? Is it something that the course team does, that they are kind of anticipating that these broader program level, if you like, outcomes are going to be picked up within modules? Or is it something that you kind of do? Is it something that's explicit amongst the team of people? How does that operate?
Obviously, in the exams, the learning outcomes are very clear, the marker criteria are very clear, and within them they've got those soft skills, and that is discussed within the revision session, of what we're looking for, that client-therapist relationship or patient-therapist relationship, and how they interact with the light of the environment in the air. Obviously, taking something into an exam is a fox setting, it's a bit fox, but it's as real as we can make it. We start the module by introducing that this is a profession and not just a subject. So with the induction, their first session is about professionalism and what's their perspective of professionalism. What do they deem as to be professional if they went to a lecture, a seminar or a practical? And then they get them to write rules of what they...
I think what I'm trying to get at is, how do you as a practitioner know that you need to be looking at those things? So how do you work with your team?
We are within the marker criteria, with the team, when we look at designing the module, so I kind of wasn't...
No, it's okay, I wasn't very clear.
They are written within the actual module guidelines, the learning outcomes of the module, so it's very...
So that's the module level,
yeah.
But what about this sort of program level? Because I was getting the feeling that you're kind of, in a way...
So when we did the revalidation, yeah. So the revalidation, we look at the HCPC and the CSP expectations of what they would ideally want as a graduate, because we have to tailor our course to the professions that we're accountable to. So the overarching consensus of what we see as a professional and a graduate, a BSc level is written first, and then we kind of deconstruct that down as to how we're going to bring that into the learning outcomes, how we're going to bring that into the modules. So when we've just revalidated our course, we've done a whole module on patient-centred care. So there's a whole module on the holistic management of patients and the eclectic skills that physios can bring to a multidisciplinary team. So looking at the wider aspects of healthcare, the setting of healthcare, complexity of your patients, your personal perspective and health belief, and your patient's health belief, and how they can conflict and get them to critically analyse that. And that's a whole module in itself. So we started off with a framework of this is what a physiotherapist is, this is what a graduate is, this is what the HCPC recommends. That we have
so now taking that knowledge that's what you want, and you're in a way embedding it into the assessment that you're doing, as well as the module criteria that you have for your specific module. And that kind of essence of doing that has all been part of the fact that you were part of that planning team.
Yeah, and the planning team's not just the academics, it's also the clinicians, service, the service user, the HCPC and the CSP. They're all
invited,
and students
forgot the name. I think really that, the essence I think that I'm getting from that is the importance of being involved in actually designing the bigger picture, not just the individual module.
Yeah, and that's what we did, is we had the bigger picture, and then we said, right, how are we going to do this? How are we going to make this big picture for 3 years, so many credits, and divided it up.
That's
an ideal almost, isn't it?
Yeah, it also relates to what you said about setting expectations at the beginning. It's almost like that professionalism, it's a physio, isn't it? Being a physiotherapist, you're setting that as the immediate context for everything, and it's kind of pervasive really and implicit through everything you're doing. So modules chunk everything up, but sounds like it's all very cohesive as a course, so the modules are the chunks, but it all sits together so well because of that whole culture for the course and that you're producing a professional. Mm. So the holistic approach comes through everything.
Yeah, it has to.
And it's probably difficult to actually pin it down, the tangibles, you know, your assessment tasks and so on, but producing a professional, it's almost like you can't measure that. It's almost in the ether, but you've designed the course in such a way that's developed as you go through.
Yeah, and I think sometimes students, like one particular module that we've got, they, because it's so holistic and they're quite young and they haven't got the experience that we have, I think, in a holistic approach, that critical evaluation and, you know, lateral thinking comes a little bit with time as well and experience and exposure. And I think the younger ones sometimes don't quite grasp what that means, and they find it hard to hang coats on. And reflection as well is really hard, and that's why it's really important that we embed it from the beginning, so they slowly start to grasp what we really truly mean by reflecting, you know. And so that's why it's, and it links quite well in with the interprofessional modules as well. So we've got to think about the interprofessional modules that are embedded into our course, which are department-wide modules as well. So they've got to make a succinct link as well, which is kind of difficult at times.
Okay, brilliant. Okay,
and
what have you got?
I've got this one, which is language, and I think it's probably very similar to your Gates and Harrison's Act, because I think it's the importance of language and conveying what's wanted and clarity about what you're expecting from students in terms of their assessment. Plain English. I can remember when I was a lecturer, I was just started here quite a considerable amount of time ago, and I happened to correct somebody's essay question, and I said, I'm not doing it. You completely went for it and don't have it in any way. But I looked at it and I thought, is my students, because I'm sharing this module with you, they are not going to understand what that means, because it's not even in English. So, but it's also about criteria. It's from Barnsley. No, it was nothing to do with an international or somebody from English wasn't their first language. It was about clarity, and I think it's about clarity about in terms of the marking criteria as well. So that students know what you want from them and learn about what you want. I picked up this one, and I'm not quite sure what I mean by this one. I think there's something about the collaborative peer learning and in terms of assessment and feedback, how we can really utilise students to support students in developing. So it's another thing you're talking about. That there are scenarios that you can build the income where students can feedback to fellow students in a peer sort of way, how well they're doing, what their work's like, etc. But I think also it's that notion of practical as well, and applying what you're learning and doing things with your learning as part of assessment. It's quite nice. Bioscience, is it? Is it bioscience? And practically. And then that one to me is a kind of feed forward. It's this kind of a business about in terms of whatever. I think we get too caught up with the notion of you've got a summative end assessment that somehow is an end point. But why should it be? Why can't it feed forward into other things? So if you're giving feedback on it, what's the student going to do with it? I think David mentioned it this morning. Student has to do something with it to learn how to think.
It's the idea that I mentioned about improving it.
Yeah. but I think that is part of it. It's the, you've got the improvement, but it's the feed forward in taking what you're learning into a new context, and that's how you learn from what you've done. So it's exactly the same thing. It's just different from us.
Okay.
What's
so,
a different image? So that one was quite good. Going on to the next thing, seeing where it all leads.
So this morning, David said should have no more than seven. So what we've got at the moment,
seven of anything.
So we've got 12 things. Although we've already identified there's some crossover here.
Should we have had nine?
Yeah. So we've got signposting and book direction, but flexibility in direction. I've got six written
down.
You can correct me when
I'm wrong.
Clarity within the curriculum. In fact, maybe you want to elaborate on any of these, but clarity within the curriculum. I don't even know what that says. Begin with the creativity, skills, and contract. What was the one again?
Enjoyment.
Oh, enjoyment, engagement, and confidence there as well.
And then you had clarity for students, guiding what the student owns, holistic approach, and then yours were language, collaboration, peer learning, and feed forward. So what do we want to get rid of?
Well, the language thing is about clarity.
Yes,
yeah, okay. So do we have a shared consensus then that clarity, something about clarity of the assessment needs to be in there? Well, now with the chairs. Get to the whiteboard.
Is the whiteboard there?
Oh, this one.
This one there?
Yeah, I'm going to use that one.
Just being awkward.
Okay, so what I want to come up with is a shared list of principles. Okay, what I normally do is when we've got small groups, each comes up with three and then we end up with a longer list. But we're going to be creative now and work together to get let's get seven shared principles. Okay, so clarity is going to be on the list, yeah? It wasn't that Dave Nichols' first one anyway.
Yeah, we're all watching,
aren't we? Yeah. Yeah, hope you're not checking back with your notes in this morning.
Not much.
Okay, what else then? So out of the discussions we've had, what pops up to the forefront of your mind about what makes assessment good? Or what do we need to consider to make assessment good?
Clear, well, finally, it needs to be succinct within the module, so the assessment has to demonstrate learning so the students can see the.
Do you mean relevant?
Relevance to.
Which sort of. So I was saying about subject. It's got. And for us, I mean, you get a lot of feedback. If you're not careful, you get a lot of stuff that's not scientific.
It's relevant, and it's also there's something about what you're assessing on also does have some value associated to it. It's saying something about what we value as well in that subject. Mm-hmm. If you like, we're talking about the relevance or what we're actually assessing. Has to be important. Does that make sense? Mm. You're not going to teach them a whole bunch of stuff and then go off and do an assessment. Or something that was an end for it, but that actually is not really, really saying it. Mm. All right, you're giving us our list.
Yeah, I think that's probably better, so we can see what's in front of us.
So you could say it's a relevant skill.
Are skills different?
Well, it's
skills different.
Skills different.
Knowledge and understanding, skills, and I think you can perhaps break skills down in terms of sort of academic skills and employability, or whatever you want to call them, professional skills.
Thank you. So those things that you've mentioned so far. It's interesting you start to talk about relevance because we haven't really talked about that before.
Well, I kind of got that in the subject list, which is many things, including giraffes, in biological sciences.
So you're talking about relevance as in content and subject, but there's other kind of relevance as well, isn't it? Like relevance to real world or
that's skills and stuff, isn't it?
Yeah. It's true for skills as well, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because actually, most of our content will be out of thing.
Yeah, you've got to evolve.
Much.
It's got to much stay.
But that's part of the skill stuff. It's transferable skills, isn't it? Because within the science context, a lot of the sort of underpinning knowledge is transferable into different contexts as that evolves.
Yeah, and the other thing is, well, into the new sessions, it's
It's new knowledge, isn't it? Yeah. It's just taking it into.
We're trying to establish a list of seven things.
We're a bit stuck on the content page, come back to that.
So we've got clarity. Things that we mentioned, so we've got clarity and clear language. And this is slightly different though, this is yours, clarity within curriculum. So what did you mean?
Well, that was that, let's get back to this is that content.
So really you're talking about relevance of the content there, so.
That's all
part
of
that one.
So it's really about, it's establishing that all these things that we've talked about, what are the most important things, if we're going to establish what our shared understanding of what good assessment is, or principles of assessment, what would our seven most important things
be? Another one is that holistic approach, that what we're not doing is we're not focusing our assessment purely at, if you like, just a module level. That in the majority of cases, you're looking at a broader picture as well as just the module.
Mm.
Not saying that you can't just, there's no reason in a program why you can't have the odd module that's totally self-contained.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
But as a generalised view, if you like, of
the end
assessment, that you need to look at your program level criteria as well as your module level criteria and be using that as a means of taking the students forward. Yeah. Otherwise, it is
combined studies, which I used to run.
Mm.
But doesn't that link back to relevance as in each sort of assessment in your modular, each content that's being assessed, subject area, needs to have context and fit in with the holistic approach.
Context.
But I think these are the same thing. Relevance, content, subject area, the holistic approach, they're kind of linked.
Mm.
Some of, you know, and this is a general principle, this isn't a what you have to do here or here. As a general principle, it's got to be linked, it's got to be possible to put into a context, it's got to fit in somewhere with a holistic approach, not be out with it.
So is it a short way of describing what you've just said?
No.
Maybe it's designed.
Yes.
Designed, yes.
Well designed, well designed. Well designed to have context and
I think
right down to,
you've got to
know where it sits in the detail,
right through to
the
overall. I think if we pick one word, I think design is probably the one that would fit with all of those.
Because it's that not too broad? Isn't all assessment design?
Is that principles so broad?
Yeah, but if I say to you, a principle of good assessment is that it's designed.
Well designed.
Then you start to go into some of the other things. I think it's too broad. You're right, this is a top level principle, but I think it's a bit too broad. What is it about that design? What's really important about what you're doing about that design? Is it that it's course focused? Is it course focused that we're talking about? Or is it something
course focused, course centred? If that label, if you like, is about when you're designing. You design a program or a course and you consider in terms of the design of that the assessments that will happen at module level.
Mm.
so that you don't end up like the business school did a few years ago, where all of the students did group work in every single module in their final year and hated it. That there are good principles of assessment, like but it doesn't mean to say that they're all going to be that. So I'm doing a lot of this, aren't I?
I think we should put it aside, come back to it.
Okay.
What about informed?
Informed. That's another new one. Informed by what or who's informed? What do you mean? We're getting a longer list here. You're supposed to be owning it down.
So I think you should come back to it. I was
worried you wouldn't be able to fill the time.
I think an easier one is around enjoyment, engagement.
Okay. Enjoyment and engagement.
And anything else we might feel that describes that. An engagement copy for enjoyment. I think to engage.
Yeah, if you engage, you have to enjoy, don't you?
It has to
have
fun. Well, yeah. I'd like to think so.
Yeah. Because enjoyment doesn't just mean it's fun.
No.
You know, you can find something really challenging, difficult, but still enjoy.
And that engagement's the word, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
It's really good. Sadly, don't enjoy it. So it's an aspiration.
So do we think engagement should go on that board? Is it going to go in one of the seven?
Yes,
I think it has to be engaging,
doesn't
it? Because
it's...
Without engagement, you're not going to get success, are you? The students aren't going to succeed.
You don't have it in there. It's very dressed up.
Okay.
Formative.
So you start creating new ones.
Well, it's a bit like feed forward.
Although, yeah, I was just going to say,
formative. That can be fed forward. Because formative on its own doesn't necessarily mean feed forward, you have to.
Yeah.
Formative and feed forward.
Okay, you two have gone quiet.
It could be drawing on stuff from the past, it could be aspiring.
Does formative
I would think context needs to go into that, definitely, in the seven. Because that is the whole point of our assessment, is having context, isn't it? So I think if something's clear and it's engaging and it has context,
almost there.
Yeah.
Context.
Formative and feed forward. Is there another holistic word for formative and feed forward? Do you mean like advancing each assessment, each individual assessment, each piece of assessment, everything that we assess on should actually help improve?
Well, I think it's the feedback that students get. However they get that feedback, because David Nichols talked about the internal feedback and the external feedback, so what students actually gain from doing something, as well as what others, either their peers or their teachers or anybody else who's hanging around, happens to tell them what they gain from what they're being told, what they're learning as they go forward. So it's...
If something's formative, is it not by nature feeding forward?
Yeah.
It has to, surely.
We can say that it means that, and then it could be a word, a single word. by formative, we mean this, and this.
Okay, this is very good form now. So we've got three more spaces on our list.
Something
about skills, or is that just embedded in everything else?
What is it though? Because we've got context,
we've got something that's engaging, we've got informative, which informative should theoretically explain that person has gained something by completing it. Then you could actually argue in your right. Skills would be within that formative. And context and formative would equal skills.
In context, we've sort of put knowledge and skills in.
Formative is about assessment, learning, and skills.
It's about to be a learning.
Yeah, they have to have learned an element of the context to have gauged with the formative element. So whether that's knowledge or whether that's a skill.
Which about this business about a contractualness?
I think go back to the original question about what makes assessment good. Assessment isn't good because it's about skills, is it? The assessment might be about skills, but that's not what makes it good. Do you know what I mean? It's that principle of what makes assessment valuable or useful.
I think that in assessment, if it's about the values of an assessment, then they have to have the word contract in, because we all have an element, a role to play within that process, don't we?
But if you're thinking about designing a new assessment task and you're going to use this list of principles, and the principles might cover some examples.
Then you would argue that that would be in the clarity.
It's
got to be means as well. We're talking about assessment which fundamentally below summative.
Mm-hmm.
It's got to be something which is measuring where that student is against the criteria.
Yeah.
So it's got to be a means of measuring.
Yeah.
Grading. Whatever you want to call it, against a given set of criteria.
So is that something that you describe as a principle that would make the resulting assessment good?
It's got to be good, it's got to be, because you can have, that can be very bad,
yeah.
and that's not good.
It's got to be, it's got to be easily, I suppose that comes under clarity, isn't it, in the sense of that our assessment has to be very specific in its measurements to give clarity to the students so they can formatively move forward.
What about appropriate then?
I mean, when you talked about language, you talked about communication really. I think that's what clarity is related to as well, isn't it? It's about communication of the assessment task in a clear, easy to understand way. Yeah.
I think there is that's about many things, but the measurement, although it has to be clear, so just the engagement, the context has to be clear, and that sort of thing. But there is something, I think, separate about that ability to measure and discern and give credit where it's due.
Mm.
Because at the moment, that's still what it's about. It's, so doing that well is important in good assessment.
Mm.
So I think it would be, the long version.
Something like appropriate. You appropriately measure something in an appropriate way,
Since the science is measuring is very specific. Very specific thing to
you. I think that's part of
grading, which is a bit fluffier than measuring.
Let's part the measuring.
So we should use the word valid.
Validity comes into it. Reliability and validity.
So what encapsulates all of those things? Measurable. It doesn't feel like a principle to me. It feels like a given. It's a part of the quality assurance process that underpins that assessment is valid and so on. I'm not comfortable with this principle, and seeing as I'm in charge, we're going to park it for now. I'm going to go back to this, because what I wanted to, because we've got three more spaces, so we might have a measurable in there. I'll give you that. But interesting that things you talked about that we've not touched on so far, I think, is that one about guiding what student owning.
Mm.
I think that's really interesting. And also about creativity. I think that's something that's really interesting. That's to me the kind of more interesting things around principles of good assessment, that an assessment is creative or it challenges students. It's
but is it so hard to be engaging?
Mm.
I think the thing is we've got
four words. We've done too well with the first few.
Yeah, I think we
but I think if it's creative and challenging, then it is allowing you to measure. So they can substitute for this business of measuring. Because they are the thing that stretches and allows people to go higher than they were, higher than they were achieving before, and that sort of thing.
Well, what do you think? I mean, I did did jokingly say I'm in charge, I'm not in charge. It's about what you think and what your principles are. So what do you feel it is? I mean, I'm just trying to pull out the things that we have in the discussion and the things that we talked a lot about, the guiding student learning, creative, don't may seem to be full in there.
From a student perspective, the other one that people talk about is learning from the assessments that you set.
Yeah.
So that you can, in some cases, I think it's in the classroom, where in setting a task, students did to actually explore what they didn't understand and then take that back into your teaching.
Yeah.
To actually spend more time.
Did you say that was formative?
But it's formative. It's formative from the start.
Yeah.
So it's about.
Could you not say these things to the staff and students? So if we flipped it and thought about clarity from a staff member's perspective, do they understand what their assessment task is about, and when they're marking it, it's clear what they're marking that piece of work on? You could do that for any of these. I think it's about flipping it, looking at it either way, isn't it? Is it engaging as a staff member assessing those students? Because a really good piece of assessment should engage everyone involved with it, surely. Because if you set an engaging task for the students, they're engaged and enthused, then surely as a staff member marking that, feeding back on that, you'll be engaged in it as well, surely. Do you think? Or is it only ever one-sided? It's not only ever one-sided, but can it be a bad experience for staff and a good experience for students?
It can be formative. You could say that it's formative for the students, but informative from the staff's perspective in terms of all of those things.
Yeah.
So you're learning from setting a piece of work.
Yeah.
You're learning about the student's understanding of what you're teaching.
Yeah.
You're learning about what they enjoy doing, what engages them, etc.
Yeah.
So maybe informative. That we could use if my colleagues think
that. I would say that's something, there's lots of things like that that fall outside of key principles that are positives,
yeah.
I would say. Because there's other examples like that.
I think that's what you're saying as well, wasn't it? That 7 is the number for policy. And
maximum of 7.
For institutional or departmental level direction, but actually when you come down to course planning, you'll have some others that are really important to your course that wouldn't necessarily be within, and those 7 or less than 7 but would really be important.
What about challenging? Or is there something about, it's got to push, there's no point having a higher education assessment that isn't.
Yeah.
Taking that comfort zone. I don't think they all have to do that, but certainly to push a bit, don't they?
Mm.
A bit or a lot, or there's got to be some push somewhere.
Yeah, because I think that's what we were when we were looking at that contract, weren't we? And that student ownership of learning is it's got to be challenging enough that the student will then take that learning further, and they won't just do the bog standard, superficial, bog standard learning answers, repetition, that they actually look at what it actually means.
So is that student ownership the same as student-centred assessment? If you design an assessment around the student, will the student automatically, are there two different things?
I'm not sure what they
mean. If the student feels they own it, then they're probably engaging it, aren't they?
Yeah. And does it mean that they can go off and do the thing that they really enjoy?
Yeah.
Within a framework, or does it mean that they
maybe these are your 4 principles?
Yeah, they feel like they encompass most things.
Probably why we've had such a long discussion trying to look at
the or it fits in there somewhere.
Yeah, that actually, if a student's owning their assessment, they're engaged in it. Challenging.
This is the thing about learning, the formative involves all the learning stuff.
If it's challenging, it will be Will it be engaging with the child? That's possible.
No, they're different things, I think.
Yeah, so do we want challenging as another one on the list?
There's something about challenging, but actually I do believe that actually assessment should be passable. It shouldn't set it so high and exciting and tough that actually...
Challenging shouldn't mean that.
You have to jump really high every time, because actually then you don't get a kind of... a kind of 40% third class pass. It's got to do that, both of those things, if that's the level.
It's
got to be allowed that level.
You've got to have something that's challenging but doable.
But
because
doable,
it impacts
yeah.
on the
yeah.
motivation of the student,
exactly, yeah.
which then has a detrimental effect
yeah.
because they feel that they can't
yeah.
achieve
yeah.
and therefore
yeah.
you kind of set them up.
Mm.
So I'm arguing at the moment that some of that stuff is too challenging. You've got six exam questions and they all challenge. Whereas actually a paper should have, or at least within, should have. Somewhere.
Did you use earlier on the word discerning?
Discerning, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, this, yeah. Not over-challenging.
So it should allow the breadth and range of marks, but also enable students to particularly challenge. Okay, we're out of time, actually. So this is your list of five principles, less than seven. Very good. And I think the thing I would say to take away from that list and also the conversation and the thinking that went into that list is to reflect upon your own assessment tasks. So think about the assessments that you've set students recently or ones you may be working on now, and think about does that assessment task that you've written or in the process of writing actually measure up to your own principles? So if you use clarity as an example. Is it written in plain English? Can you confidently say that, yeah, the students will understand what I've asked of them and they will feel engaged in that, they'll be challenged and so on. So I think hopefully you found the discussion today useful and interesting. I certainly enjoyed it. But it's about going away and thinking about your own practice and how does your own practice measure up against your own values and principles. Thank you very much for your efforts.
Thank you.
I will never underestimate how much discussion can go on amongst three people every day. It's really good.